no better guest to speak to on National Rhode Island Day than Bob Burke himself. Bob, welcome.
Hey, good morning. Welcome. Happy Rhode Island Day.
Happy Rhode Island Day to you, which I hear word on the street is you are R.I. Burke.
In fact, my initials are R.I. Burke. Yeah. And I grew up on Roger Williams Avenue. So I guess I'm dyed in the wool Rhode Islander. I'll never be able to move.
I love that. You are the man to talk to. So let's jump right in, starting off with a little Rhode Island history. Some people might be familiar with the fact of Roger Williams, how we founded it. But can you give us like a rough breakdown of, you know, why that was the case and what happened with the discovery of Rhode Island?
Sure. Well, we go back 550 million years to the bedrock below us. The glaciers changed all of that about 75,000 years ago. The ice melted about 10,000 years ago, formed the river, the bay, and then people started coming here after that. And in 1636, Roger Williams came here and officially founded the state of Rhode Island.
Brendan was quizzing us on some Rhode Island trivia as well. You know, why did he want to discover Rhode Island? And where did he discover it first? Is there like a section of, you know, a city, town now that we know of, you know, where he maybe first stepped foot or first declared that it was a state?
Yeah, he didn't have much choice. He'd been convicted in Boston for preaching separation of church and state, came down and settled on a spring in Rumford, thinking that he was on the Indian lands. He wasn't. He was still in Plymouth, and he had to skedaddle. They were going to come and arrest him because he was on the lam. He was America's first most wanted. And then he came across to Gano Street over near where the Dunkin' Donuts was, probably for a culotta. And he landed on Founders Rock, which we later blew up in an accidental explosion trying to turn it into a park. And he actually came around Fox Point.
Wow.
And settled where the Roger Williams Memorial is today, because there was a beautiful spring there and fresh water was really important. So, yeah, that's where he eventually made the actual settlement.
You just mentioned that memorial, and a lot of people can visit these sites now. And another site, another iconic man, is that of the Independent Man. And you have some fun facts regarding him.
Well, he's cool. And if you look up the hill from the Roger Williams Memorial, there he is on top of the State House. He's 14 feet tall, weighs almost 5,000 pounds, size 54 shoes, just dressed in a loincloth. I mean, come on. Where's his mittens? This is Rhode Island. The guy needed a hoodie. So he's up there pretty much half naked all year long, and he has been the symbol since that State House was built at the turn of the last century in the 1900s.
Bob, do we know, was this Independent Man, you know, carved or created after an individual? Like, did they have some sort of inspiration behind who they were trying to, you know, make the Independent Man out to be?
One of the stories, there are numerous stories, it's not clear how he came to be. One of them is that a South American dictator had a statue made of himself, and it was supposed to be shipped. There were all these wonderful foundries in Providence, a lot of casting being done back in that time. And they said that he didn't have the money to pay for it. And the rumor is one of two things happened. Either they just put him up there and called him the Independent Man, or they melted him down and made the metal into what we now know as the Independent Man. So either way, as always in Rhode Island, it's a mystery.
And there's a lot of mysteries surrounding him. A lot of people have their own stories, their own beliefs of maybe even some sort of like romantic stories I'm hearing. I mean, what's the strangest, I guess, rumor you could say that you've heard about the Independent Man?
Well, I actually at one time tried to get the governor of Texas to give us a dowry because they have a beautiful woman on their state house.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, this guy's been up there over a century without a date. I mean, Brendan's the only one who's got a longer streak than that. And I thought, you know, we ought to get them together and have them give us money in a dowry, you know, $1 billion or something to help us out. But you never know. He could be gay. Maybe we want to fix him up with the Brave on top of the Oklahoma State House. But I think these guys are lonely. They're up there, beautiful view, but they're all alone. So I think we should work with other states and maybe get them a date and, you know, a little more social life, right? After a century, you should be able to
do
that.
He could use it. And quickly, before we let you go, Bob, yeah. I mean, you've always shared so many fun facts and stories, but what truly sparked your interest in diving so deep into the history of Rhode Island?
It's fascinating. History in other places is as dry as toast. Nothing ever happened. But here in Rhode Island, oh my God. You know, we're the smallest state, we're the biggest name, we've got so many things happening at all at once. Our actual birthday is May 29th, which makes us a Gemini, and all the Geminis, anybody knows astrology? Rhode Island is truly a Gemini. And I just think that's the fun of it. If I was born in Nebraska, I would have been into math. You know, I wouldn't have bothered with history because there's nothing ever interesting that has ever happened or probably ever will happen in Nebraska. But Rhode Island, every day is a great new story.
And you are part of that interesting history, that's for sure, Bob. Thank you so much for joining us. And we talked a lot about the Independent Man. Coming up a little later on in the show, we're actually going to show a picture of when Will Gilbert had the chance to stand next to him. And no, he wasn't at the top of the building, so stay tuned for that.